Hey folks, welcome to your second set of AP Chemistry video notes. Today we're going to cover topics 1.5 through 1.8. My goal is for you to ultimately understand and remember into the future that atoms and molecules can be identified by their electron distribution and energy, as well as to understand that the periodic table shows patterns in electron structure and trends in atomic properties. Topics 1.5 through 1.8 ask you to represent the electron configuration of atoms or ions of an element using the off-ball principle, explain the relationship between the photoelectron spectrum of an atom or ion and the electron configuration of the species, as well as the interactions between the electron and the nucleus, explain the relationship between the trends and atomic properties of elements and electronic structure and periodicity, and explain the relationship between trends in the reactivity of elements and periodicity. Let's get started. As you should already know, the atom is made up of a nucleus and an electron cloud. The nucleus is small, dense, and positively charged, and houses the protons and neutrons. The electron cloud is vast, not dense, and negatively charged, and houses the electrons. One of the most important phrases you'll need for the AP exam is Coulombic forces of attraction. When you hear that phrase, you should automatically be thinking about Coulomb's law. Coulomb's law helps us to calculate the force between two charged particles. We usually use this to discuss the forces between the positive nucleus and the negative outer shell electrons, ergo the forces of attraction, not repulsion. The equation looks like this, where Q1 and Q2 are the charges of the particles in question, and r is the distance between them. This is an equation you'll want to get familiar with and memorize, as it won't be given to you on the AP exam. Qualitatively looking at this equation, when you have larger charges, your forces of attraction are larger. When you have a greater distance between your particles, your forces of attraction are lower. We'll see this concept in action a little bit later, when we start talking about periodic trends. You can think of the electrons in atoms or ions as being in particular energy levels or shells and sublevels or subshells. These shells and subshells are described by the electron configuration. The inner electrons are called core electrons, and the electrons in the highest principal energy level, or the energy level furthest from the nucleus, are called valence electrons. You can use Coulomb's law to qualitatively estimate the relative energy required to remove an electron from different subshells of an atom. If the electrons are closer to the nucleus, there are higher forces of attraction, therefore it takes more energy to pull that electron away. You can also compare the electrons in the same subshell of different atoms. For example, lithium compared to nitrogen. Both of these atoms have their valence electrons in the same energy level, so the distance between the nucleus and those electrons should be about the same. But lithium only has one electron in its outer shell, and it has four less protons in its nucleus. The nucleus doesn't have as high of a charge to pull that electron towards it. This is referred to as the effect of nuclear charge. On the other hand, nitrogen has four more protons and has four electrons in its outer shell, giving it a higher effective nuclear charge. Since the charges are greater, the Coulombic forces of attraction is greater, and those electrons get pulled in closer to the nucleus, making the atom smaller. You may remember the electron orbital energy diagram from Chem 1 or Chem 2. As an AP Chem student, you have to memorize the order of the subshells for electron configuration, as this will not be given to you on the AP exam. In this diagram, each principal energy level is represented by the principal energy number 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5. The sublevels in each energy level are represented by S, P, D, and or F. Then each line, or sometimes box or circle, in each sublevel represents the separate orbitals that electrons can exist in within that sublevel. As you may remember, the sublevels S, P, D, and F have 1, 3, 5, and 7 orbitals, respectively. This diagram also helps illustrate the relative amounts of energy for each orbital, as well as the relative distance from the nucleus. The more energy a sublevel has, the farther it is from the nucleus. So, how do we fill this out? Well, there are three rules we have to follow. The most important one is the off-ball principle, which tells you that you have to start with the lowest energy orbital and then work your way up. In other words, no matter what element you're writing the electron configuration for, the first electron you place will always be a 1s electron. The Pauli exclusion principle says that we can't have more than two electrons in the same orbital. And if we do have two electrons in the same orbital, they have to spin in opposite directions. We usually represent these electrons as up and down electrons. Finally, Hund's rule states that when you're filling orbitals in the same sublevel, such as the 2p sublevel, you have to place one up electron in each orbital before you can go back and start pairing them with down electrons. Since these three orbitals are at the same level of energy here, the electrons like to spread out as much as they can. For example, if we were to write the electron configuration for phosphorus, you'd start down here at the 1s and place electrons as follows. Phosphorus has 15 protons, so it has 15 electrons when it's an atom. Once you get your electrons filled in, you'd write out the electron configuration, naming each energy level and sublevel with an exponent that corresponds to how many electrons are in that sublevel, like this. You might also remember that electron configuration is directly tied to the periodic table. This is by far the easiest way to remember the order of the sublevels. The S block is the first two columns in pink here. All of the elements in the very first column will have an electron configuration that ends in S1. All the elements in the second column will have an electron configuration that ends in S2. From there, we can jump over to the P block, which is the aqua colored section, clear over to the right. Starting with the boron column, our electron configurations here would end in P1, P2, P3, etc. The important thing to note here is that for the S and P blocks, the principal energy level for the valence electrons is the same as whatever row that element is in. So for sulfur, its electron configuration will end in 3P4. 3 because it's in row 3, and P4 because it's in the fourth column in the P block. The rest of the table works the same exact way, except the D block in the middle, mostly the transition metals, their principal energy level is one less than the row it's in. And the F block's principal energy level, the lanthanides and actinides clear at the bottom, is 2 less than the row it's in. Some elements are really tricky and don't follow all of the rules for electron configuration, but you won't be asked about those on the AP exam. For the most part, you can assume that the elements you're asked about will follow the same general rules, and you can determine the electron configuration completely based on the element's location on the periodic table. Something that's completely new to you this year is photoelectron spectroscopy. This is how we quantitatively determine and measure the electron configuration of an element. We can directly measure the binding energy of electrons using a photoelectron spectrometer. The graph we get from this shows various peaks. The horizontal or left to right position of each peak is related to the energy required to remove an electron from its subshell. And the height of each peak is proportional to how many electrons are in that subshell. It may seem odd, but we graph the x-axis backwards so that the electrons that require the most energy to remove, and the ones that are closest to the nucleus, are on the left. This puts our peaks in the same order as the electron configuration goes. Let's look at some of these PES spectrums. You'll likely be given a spectrum like one of these and asked to identify the element. To do so, we simply start with the first peak and assume that that's the 1s subshell. For our first element here, it looks like there are two electrons in the 1s subshell, and then the next peak would be the 2s subshell, and there's only one electron in there. That makes this element lithium. Next, we have 2 in the 1s peak, 2 in the 2s, and only 1 in 2p. This would represent boron. Notice the 1s electrons in lithium take less energy to remove than those of boron. Why do you think that is? Well, as we'll see, boron is a smaller atom than lithium is, so the 1s electrons are closer to the nucleus than those in lithium, making them harder to pull away. Try these other two out on your own. I get neon for the top one and aluminum for the bottom one. Due to the intense level of organization within the periodic table, we can easily predict certain trends among the elements. We're going to talk about four of those now. The atomic radius of an atom is the distance between the nucleus and the outermost electrons. The nuclear charge is directly related to the atomic size and is determined by the number of protons. If you have more protons, you have a higher nuclear charge. Since the elements in the same row have the same highest principal energy level, the only way we can compare their size is by looking at the nuclear charge. As we move from left to right, we add protons, therefore increasing the nuclear charge. As we increase the nuclear charge, the nucleus can pull those outer electrons closer to it. So as we move from left to right on the periodic table, our atoms get smaller. As we move down a column on the periodic table, we add energy levels, or shells, of electrons. This makes our atom much bigger. Since the atomic radius increases from top to bottom and from right to left, francium is our largest element. Understanding the trend in atomic radius is by far the most important, as the rest of these trends can be reasoned from there. When an atom loses or gains electrons, it becomes an ion. The radius of an ion is different than the radius of its atom because the effective nuclear charge is different. When an atom loses electrons, it becomes positive and becomes a cation. It now has less electrons, but the same amount of protons. This increases our effective nuclear charge, so the nucleus can pull the outer electrons in closer. If an atom gains electrons to become an anion, it gets larger. This is because we keep the same number of protons, but we're adding electrons, therefore reducing our effective nuclear charge. The outer electrons want to spread away from each other more, and the nucleus doesn't have the strength to hold them in tight. The ionization energy is the amount of energy it takes to remove an electron from its subshell. In doing this, you create a cation. The smaller the atom is, the closer its outer electrons are to the nucleus, and therefore the harder it is to pull the electron away, so it has a higher ionization energy. The larger an atom is, the farther the outer electrons are from the nucleus, and the easier it is to pluck one of those electrons off. Therefore, it has a lower ionization energy. So, as the atomic size increases, the ionization energy decreases, effectively making this trend run in the opposite direction as the atomic radius. That means that francium, being the biggest atom, will have the smallest ionization energy. Electronegativity is the ability of an atom to attract shared electrons toward it. This has a lot to do with Coulomb's law again. If the atom is smaller, fluorine being the smallest, the nucleus is closer to the electrons that it's sharing with another atom, and it can pull those electrons closer. Since fluorine is the smallest atom, it has the highest electronegativity. Electron affinity is how much the energy changes when an atom becomes negatively charged. Energy is released when atoms want to gain an electron, and when it's easier for the atoms to gain an electron, such as in the top right of the periodic table. You would think that fluorine would have the highest electron affinity because it's in the top right position and it's the smallest atom. But since it's so small, the 7 electrons in its outer shell are already pretty close together, and adding another electron pushes them together even more. Chlorine, a larger atom, can more easily handle the addition of another electron, therefore it releases even more energy than fluorine. That's the only oddball, though. From there, the trend follows true. The electron affinity decreases as you go down in a column. As you move toward the left, atoms want to lose electrons, not gain them. As you go towards the bottom, the atoms are larger, so the nucleus can't attract the electrons quite as easily. Therefore, the further left and down you go on the periodic table, the more energy it takes to add an electron to the atom, and therefore the smaller the electron affinity. Knowing how to find the electron configuration and how to determine the number of valence electrons is extremely important when characterizing our elements. The interactions between valence electrons and the nuclei of elements determine how likely two elements are to form a chemical bond. Since elements in the same column of the periodic table have the same number of valence electrons, they tend to form similar compounds and form ions with similar charges. When atoms form ionic compounds, the charges they form are governed by their location on the periodic table and how many valence electrons they have. Remember, the octet rule says that atoms want to have at least 8 electrons in their outer shell. To do this, atoms will gain, lose, or share electrons until they get there. When writing the electron configuration of an ion, you'd write the electron configuration of the atom first, and then add or remove electrons in or from the highest principal energy level. This will make more sense as we practice it, but basically, you can learn just about everything you need to know by looking at an element's location on the periodic table. If that didn't quite make sense before, hopefully it will after we look at some of these examples. If magnesium can form a compound with fluorine, what other elements might you expect to form a compound with fluorine in the same ratio? Well, if you're asked a question like this, don't even bother to take the time to figure out what the molecular formula for magnesium fluoride is. You should automatically be able to recognize that Mg will form a similar bond to F as any other element in the same column. So in this case, you could answer with beryllium, calcium, strontium. Any of those elements in the alkaline earth metals column should form a similar compound with fluorine. Question 2 gives you a list of different oxides or oxygen compounds that alkali metals make. Hydrogen makes H2O and H2O2. Lithium makes Li2O and Li2O2. Sodium makes Na2O, Na2O2, and NaO2. Potassium makes K2O, K2O2, and KO2. If you look at that closely enough, you might notice a trend. So based on that information, what oxides would you expect rubidium to make? I'd say that rubidium should make similar oxide compounds as sodium and potassium do. So Rb2O, Rb2O2, and RbO2. Our last question asks, why do Fe3 plus ions interact with water molecules more than Fe2 plus ions? Almost everything comes down to the size of the atom or ion. So which is bigger, Fe3 plus or Fe2 plus? Remember, as we lose electrons, the effective nuclear charge increases, so the electron cloud gets pulled in tighter, making the ion smaller than the atom it came from before. With that in mind, Fe3 plus should have a smaller ionic radius than Fe2 plus. It means that the valence electrons in a water molecule will be able to get closer to the nucleus of an Fe3 plus than an Fe2 plus ion. If you can explain it that way or some similar way, you should be good to go. Well, that's all for today, folks. I know that was a lot of information to cover, but I hope it helps you get on your way a little bit. I expect that the activities we do in class and our labs will help reinforce these concepts a lot more than these notes videos do, but you can always use these videos as a resource to go back to and rewatch if you have questions. If you have any questions, please let me know.